My name is Dan Cederbaum. I am the executive director of the Mordecai M. Kaplan Center for Jewish Peoplehood. And on behalf of our partners at the Program for Jewish Civilization at Georgetown University and McGill University's Department of Jewish Studies, it is my absolute pleasure and privilege to welcome you, or pre-welcome you, to Architect of the Jewish Future, a conference on the life, work, and legacy of Rabbi Mordecai M. Kaplan. I say pre-welcome because if you look at the program, and the program is very important, we're so pressed for time, we're going to assume folks are able and willing and will provide assistance to those who are not to use the program as your guide today and tomorrow. It has greetings from all three co-sponsors at the front, which I hope you'll find informative, and very importantly, the conference schedule and biographies for all the speakers, so we don't have to spend the time that we'd rather devote to substantive discussion doing bio pieces or slight the amazing resumes of our conference presenters. I will do the formal welcome and introductions with some folks from Georgetown at 1 o'clock, but we're going to kick off now with our first panel. Just a couple of quick housekeeping announcements. I've just turned off my portable device, my cell phone. Please do that. As you can see, we, and may have heard, we're very excited, thank you to Georgetown, to be webcasting this event, so that means that keeping conversation to a minimum, which is always important, is particularly important because of that. All the sessions will be archived and available for viewing on various websites after the conference, which is wonderful for those because we know people for lots of different reasons can't stay for the entire conference. I'm sorry, we had, as you saw, a demonstration outside unplanned, as far as I know, at least from our end. That has broken up. Part of the problem with that is that I'm told parking was taken by a lot of the protesters. I think that situation will ease. See me if you still have issues about parking today or tomorrow or the shuttle vans that are going to be running to and from the Marriott. So we now turn to our first panel, Kaplan and his JTS students. It is my pleasure to introduce Rabbi Dr. Emanuel Goldsmith, one of Kaplan's foremost students, but for me, always has a special place as my parents' former beloved former rabbi. So I'm just with that. It's yours, Manny.
Not former rabbi, Rabbi Emeritus. Boker Tov, a herzlichen guten Morgen, and Chodesh Tov, a guten Chodesh. Mark and Jeff and Shirley all reacted to my red yarmulke. And Shirley said, I'm wearing the red yarmulke because it's Kaplan's red letter day. But the truth is, I'm wearing the red yarmulke because I don't want to be a cardinal, I want to be the Pope. And someone said to me, the Pope wears a white yarmulke. And I replied, only on Shabbos. Speaking of Shabbos, I attend an Orthodox minyan during the week. And last Friday, somebody asked me, when is Mashiach coming? Coming. And I said, Mashiach is coming tomorrow. They said, he can't come tomorrow. Tomorrow is Shabbos. I said, it's all right. He's conservative. He rides. Without further ado, my dear colleague, Dr. William E. Kaufman.
Hey, you can clap, thank you. Thank you very much for Manny. It's a pleasure and privilege to be on your panel, Manny. Manny and I go back a long time and we're really very good friends and he just wrote the foreword to my new book, A Jewish Philosophical Response to the New Atheists, Dawkins, Dennett, Harris, and Hitchens. And the final chapter is Mordecai M. Kaplan's Transnaturalism. I critique the New Atheists because they have no respect for reconstructed ideas of God. And I show that to be false, and my main argument is Kaplan's Transnaturalism and how it how effective it is, on which I'll talk about later. Now, this talk is about my changing perceptions of Mordecai Kaplan as a student, and then after, as a pulpit rabbi and philosophical scholar. When I was a senior at Jewish Theological Seminary, I audited Kaplan's course in philosophy of religion. I was curious about Kaplan. In the 1930s and 40s, Kaplan was the main intellectual influence at the seminary, the rabbinical school. He influenced scores of rabbis. He trained them analytically. In a conversation, if the word God came up, a Kaplan student would say, "Define your terms." I was at the seminary 1959 to 1964. Kaplan was still sharp. Three incidents reflect this. First was Kaplan's discussion of the book, The Idea of the Holy, by Rudolf Otto. As you all probably know, Otto maintains that the central religious emotion is the feeling of the numinous, the mysterium tremendum, the holy. Kaplan absolutely ridiculed this, saying, "Otto bases the whole thing, that is religion, on a feeling of whizziness." Kaplan himself based religion on what he took to be a more scientific basis. We all know that Kaplan tried to be scientific. The scientific basis was Emil Durkheim's idea of religion as a collective consciousness of a society. The second incident involved a seminary student who had been a yeshiva-trained scholar. Commenting on the yeshiva Bacher's theology, Kaplan said, "At the yeshiva, they addled your mind with their dogmatism." After class, the student said to a number of us, "Kaplan is pretty dogmatic in his Epicursus." The third thing I remember very vividly, Kaplan was explaining his functionalism. He says, "What do we know about energy except the way it functions? A thing is what it does." He repeated that over and over again, "A thing is what it does." So that led to his functionalism. That one of the things that's important is how the God idea functions in society. So those are three incidents that reflect how sharp Kaplan still was between 1959 and between 1964 and 1970. My perception of Kaplan now, after the seminary, and as a rabbi, as a doctoral candidate, approximately 2 weeks before I was to take my oral examinations for a PhD in philosophy at Boston University, Kaplan came to speak at the synagogue in Woonsocket, Rhode Island, where I was the rabbi. Now, the synagogue was famous for its architecture. As a matter of fact, in the Jewish Encyclopedia, there's a picture of the Woonsocket Synagogue. And this was mainly due to a layman by the name of Arthur I. Darman. He was really a tyrant and a dictator, and you had to agree with him or else he would have your head. If you ever go to the synagogue in Woonsocket, and you hear them saying prayers, and you hear what you think is amen, it's really Darman. Now, Arthur I. Darman was a personal friend of Mordecai Kaplan, because they both liked the idea of modernizing Judaism. So once I get a call from Arthur Darman, and he says, "Would you mind if I invited Kaplan to speak?" I said, "No, that'd be fine." So during the week, I get a call. "This is Rabbi Kaplan speaking." And I thought it was Joe Kaplan, Sam Kaplan. I said, "Which Kaplan is this?" He says, "Mordecai Kaplan." I was stunned. The great Mordecai Kaplan is calling me. So he says, "I just wanted to know what kind of an audience." And I said, mainly older people. So he wanted to know what kind of an audience he was speaking to. When he came to speak, he totally amazed me. He was 89 years old at the time. He spoke for an hour and a half, and he was vigorous and vital. And I thought I would, at the seminary, people would criticize him. "Oh, he has the audacity to define God." So I thought I would ask him about that. "Dr. Kaplan," I asked, "how did you arrive at your definition of God as the power in the universe that makes for salvation?" Kaplan answered, "You realize we are speaking of the term God, how God is experienced, and not the reality of God." Now, my doctoral dissertation was about phenomenology, which is the idea that you bracket whether the thing is real or not, and you just study how it's experienced. So I was delighted that Kaplan exhibited the sophistication of phenomenology. Kaplan continued, "God means not only the power in the universe that makes for salvation, but the power within ourselves." Immediately I was gripped. Kaplan had converted me. I was absolutely enthralled at his answer to my question. Here was an approach, though different in some respects from phenomenology, which I was studying, that shared its intellectual modesty. That's the thing I always liked about Kaplan's theology. It's intellectually modest. He's not claiming to know God in God's self, but God as experienced, or God as God functions in society. No claims were made about divinity in itself, but only divinity as experienced. Here was a true religious humanism. An intellectual adventure had begun. I was to write many articles and journals about Kaplan and feature him in my book, Contemporary Jewish Philosophies. The encounter with Kaplan after graduating the seminary really changed my life. After I was so enthralled by the vigor of this 89-year-old man, I visited him frequently in New York. Even more thrilling was a walk with him in Jerusalem. He said during that walk that takana is a more important concept than halacha. And he said in the old Jewish encyclopedia, not the new one, the old one, look up takana, look up halacha, and you'll see much more on takana. If you think about it, Reconstructionism is essentially one big takana, an attempt to reenact or reconstruct Judaism to fit the modern age. And that's, of course, enshrines Kaplan's definition of Judaism as the religious civilization of the Jewish people, the evolving religious civilization. Now, Kaplan's most important concept, I think, is his transnaturalism. And one of the great thrills of my life was the following. In addition to visiting with Kaplan, we had a nice correspondence. He would always sign his letters, affectionately yours. That was nice. The most thrilling letter I ever got from Kaplan was his response to my article, The Concept of Transcendence and Reconstructionism, in which I explained the theological concept of transnaturalism. In his letter to me, after he read the article, he said, "Thank you very much. Transnaturalism is Reconstructionism's greatest contribution to Jewish theology." It's quite a statement. Transnaturalism is Reconstructionism's greatest contribution to Jewish theology. So what's the big deal about transnaturalism? In my most recent book, A Jewish Philosophical Response to the New Atheists, Dawkins, Dennett, Harris, and Hitchens, I cite Kaplan's theory of transnaturalism as the kind of revisionary theological interpretation the new atheists are blind to. All the new atheists do is criticize supernaturalism, which Kaplan does too. But they do not recognize, the new atheists do not recognize reconstructed God ideas. If it's not supernaturalism, it's not God we're talking about, according to them. So it's very important to have reconstructed God concepts, and Kaplan's transnaturalism is a beautiful example. Transnaturalism is a mediating concept between supernaturalism and reductive naturalism. Kaplan defines transnaturalism as that extension of naturalism which takes into account much that mechanistic or materialistic or positivistic science is incapable of dealing with. Transnaturalism reaches out into the domain where mind, personality, purpose, ideals, and meaning dwell. From this we see that Kaplan finds strict naturalism inadequate because it is incapable of dealing with the phenomena of mind, purpose, values, etc. Now, it's crucial to understand, what does he mean by dealing with it? What does he mean when he says mechanistic science is incapable of dealing with these phenomena? Manifestly, Kaplan is searching for an explanation of mind and values. He is seeking cosmic support for human values. Cosmic support for human values. Obviously, supernaturalism won't do. Kaplan's entire philosophy is a polemic against supernaturalism. He thus promulgates transnaturalism as a mediating concept. Now, I was reading a book called Religious Faith in 20th Century Man, and I came across the concept of transnaturalism in this. Sir Julian Huxley, in his book on scientific humanism, writes, "There remains the fundamental mystery of existence, probably the existence of mind. It remains true that many phenomena are charged with a magical quality of transcendent or even comprehensive power over our minds and introduce us to realms beyond ordinary experience. They merit a special designation. For want of better, I use the term divine, although this quality of divinity is not supernatural, but transnatural." I don't know if Kaplan got this idea from Julian Huxley or Julian Huxley got it from him, but it's interesting, the correlation here. How do we explain transnaturalism? This is how I explain it. If you take the prefix trans, T-R-A-N-S, one meaning, which I found in the Webster's Collegiate Dictionary, is through and through so as to change completely. God, for Kaplan, if we remove the phenomenological brackets, is the creative process which transforms the chaos of the universe into an organic whole. God is thus cosmic creativity that cannot be reductively explained by the laws of nature. It is what he calls the plus of nature. God as transcendent, transnatural creativity functions as a source of moral value, which Kaplan calls wisdom, or a sense of values. He writes, "The wisdom by which man is expected to control and direct his life reflects the cosmic wisdom by which God's laws govern all nature. The laws of nature are God's immanent functioning. Creativity is God's transcendent functioning." Again, I repeat this quote from Kaplan, "The wisdom by which man..." He was old-fashioned, of course. He should have said, "by which women or by which individuals are expected to control and direct their lives reflects the cosmic wisdom by which God's laws govern all nature." We are all wiser for our encounter with Mordecai M. Kaplan, who surely was an embodiment of divine wisdom. Thank you.
Good morning. An old friend of mine said, "Oh, what are you doing here?" when he saw me this morning. "I didn't know you were a Bucky in Kaplan." Well, I want to tell you, he's absolutely right. But I want to tell you why I am here. I'm here not because I'm a Bucky in anything. I'm here because I was privileged to be a student of Mordecai Kaplan, and that's why I'm here, and that's why I deserve to be here. I don't know most of you. I wish I did. But I did know Mordecai Kaplan. My father, Alav Shalom, and mom were Orthodox Jews and ardent Zionists. I never went to a public school in my whole life. I went to yeshivot ketanot, Orthodox yeshivas, and I graduated from Yeshiva University as an Orthodox Jew after spending 1 year at the Hebrew University. I hardly remember what happened 10 years ago, let alone 57 years ago. So please excuse me. It was 57 years ago that I took another step in my own self-discovery. I became a student of Dr. Kaplan, and he helped me understand who I was and reinforced the direction of my future. In his book, Judaism as a Civilization, on the first page, the page of dedication, he writes, "L'zecher avi mori, harav Yisrael Kaplan, naki hadat v'atzil haruach, שהיה לי לעיניים בטעותי בישימון הספק והמבוכה." In memory of my father, my teacher, Rav Yisrael Kaplan, with a clear mind and a noble spirit, he was my eyes, as I erred and wandered in the desert of doubt and confusion. My dear friends, I'm still wandering in that desert of doubt and confusion, and I, as I sit here, I'm more aware, listening and hearing, that I am still in doubt and still in confusion. Naki dat is an expression by Chazal. Sensitive, discerning, careful, judicious, sagacious, Amud Eish, Mordecai Kaplan was exactly that for me. When I first entered his classroom, the first thing I heard were my knees knocking. I was so scared and so intimidated and so frightened that he would say, "Spar!" I remember his hair, the expression of his eyes, his hands moving and his arms moving in all directions, and his mouth moving in all directions as well. I was intimidated by his manner of speech and amazed by his ability to pierce and embrace who I was and whom I was ultimately to become. When I first met Mordecai Kaplan, I sensed by his words and manner that he was sad. He was very sad at the seminary. He spoke about that sadness frequently in class and outside of class. And because I don't do Lashon Hara, I don't know whether it was him or it was the institution. I don't go there. That's not my business, and I don't have that wisdom. He frequently in class and in private spoke of that discomfort and his desire to be elsewhere. But he almost like sang the song, "Tell me where shall I go?" There was no Reconstructionist college at that time. In Talit and Tfilin, I felt the power of his search for that power which makes for salvation. You know what that means? I don't know what it means for you, but I do know what it means for me. And that's what's important. And that's what's so brilliant about Reconstructionist Judaism. Seated in our class was a student by the name of Carl. Carl, together with his wife, drove to Boston to share with their family the great news of their becoming parents. They were in a fatal automobile accident and never made it to Boston. Each one of us at the seminary searched for some answers and direction in coping with our loss. And now is not the time, but to sum it up in one phrase, Kaplan taught me that no one has a monopoly on mourning. Not the Torah and not the Talmud, and no book, and not death and dying, not Kubler-Ross. No one has a monopoly. And I've taken that in my heart as I've gone through my own career and life, having lost a young wife and raising three children. It meant a great deal to me personally. We spent a lot of time that semester coping with death and tragedy and the dying of a student in our class, seeking meaningful consolation. To sum it up, Kaplan was the king of Akshonis. It was his point of view. That's where it started, and that's where it ended. He had a subtle and caustic sense of humor. You wouldn't want to be in that sense of humor. Frequently, he was accompanied by students on his walk home from JTS. And about 10 or 12 times, I did that walk with him. And I told my mom that I was going to do that. So my mom correctly said, "Elliott?" I said, "Yeah." She says, "Remember, you have two ears and one mouth. Listen twice as much as you speak." I had the privilege in Jerusalem when he asked me to help him change the library in his home and move the books to a more comfortable and accessible place. What an honor. Not there, not there. That's not where I want it. Okay, all right. All right. What are you doing? What are you doing? He said, you know what? Maybe you shouldn't do it. I said, whatever you want. It's all right. 2 days I was into that. Then he said, I want to establish a Sanhedrin. I said, okay, I'm in the spirit of Hillel and Shammai and Rav Papa. You can add Spar. I'll become part of your Sanhedrin. But the Sanhedrin was really something important to him. The reestablishment of the Sanhedrin was really important, and he referred to it frequently. And think about what would be now if we had a Sanhedrin instead of Rav HaRoshi here and a Rav HaRoshi there and fighting, and this one's in jail and that one's not in jail. I don't even know. I was a Mossadnik. I went to Mossad for many years. But on many occasions, thank you. On occasions, I had a day off. If Shlomo and Rivka agreed to it. Not today, next week you'll get it. Okay, so where did we go very often? We went to a camp called Seduin. And who was at Camp Seduin? He was some tennis player. He was some baseball player. Not Kaplan, some other person. But he did throw the ball with kids and young people. He spoke to kids, spoke to young people, made a difference, changed their lives, was strong and powerful. And then chutzpah. I needed to speak to chutzpah, so I said, chutzpah, help me. They say, Elliott, you don't have no trouble with chutzpah. I said, okay. So I went to see Mordecai Kaplan. I said, Rabbi Kaplan, can you install me as a rabbi? He says, sure, I want to do that for you. I said, really? He says, yeah. He says, where are you being installed? He said, how far? I said, it's 2.5 hours drive from New York. It's in Smithtown, New York. He wasn't exactly 50 years old. The congregation was a very tiny congregation. It grew, and then it didn't grow. I've left it in the year 2000. But in 1962, he installed me as a rabbi with humor, sensitivity, with a personal challenge to me, and a personal challenge to the congregation that allowed the congregation, without being called a Reconstructionist congregation, because there was no real such thing at that time, to be a Reconstructionist congregation, and for me to be a Reconstructionist rabbi. From that day on, his Naki Da'at and Hatzil Ruach allows me to live with my many mistakes and with a lack of bekiut on Reconstructionist Judaism, to continue in my wilderness of doubt and confusion, and yet with a sense of pride, shalom and shalva. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Happy Chodesh. I begin with an anecdote that's 99 years old. In 1915, and from Kaplan's diaries, I am never so convinced of the futility of the courses in pedagogy given by the Teachers College at Columbia as when I see X teach. It is now the third or fourth year that he has been taking courses at Columbia University, and with all that, there was nothing that gave the least evidence as of his having benefited by that training. It was a poorly organized lesson. No single idea was made to stand out with sufficient clearness for the children to carry away with them. His Hebrew, for he taught the lesson in Hebrew, was of the poorest. Again, I have occasion to repeat that I that what I stated once before, that is that if the Benderly had not held up the PhD ideal for them, but had brought pressure to bear upon them to acquire a better command of the language and of the literature, and to do more practical teaching, he would have made real teachers out of them. I choose to begin with Kaplan as educator. I was a student at the Jewish Theological Seminary from 1942 to 1947. He was the head of the Teachers Institute as he had been since 1909. Education was defined by certain insights that were natural and then were sharpened in Kaplan himself as an educator. He had to take on those people who were in love with education only to get the PhD degree. That's what he was referring to here. They were the so-called Benderly boys. He had to contend with some who were using the Teachers Institute to further their own cause, in some case, secular humanism, et cetera, et cetera. What's important to realize is that as the years have moved on for me, I find myself remembering him in front of the classroom of the rabbinical school. It was the only class at the rabbinical school in which there was interaction between the student and the teacher, the only one. He taught two classes primarily in my day, philosophies of Judaism or philosophies of religion, and we used to say that's because the administration of the seminary would not allow him to say a philosophy. He had to pluralize it. And in that, he taught us what it was to live in the civilization of West of the West. He made us read Spinoza. We had no idea what he was talking about because of what Spinoza was talking about because we didn't have background. But he raised our expectations and our understanding of Western thought. It was very important. It was a breath from outside. At one point, and this is the first time I've ever related this in public, I asked for an appointment to meet with him. He invited me to come to his home, and I said, I'm ready to drop out of this institution. All they want to do is infantilize me, make me have no growth as an adult, and teach me one subject without any reference to its relationship to the rest of the curriculum, namely more and more Gemara. The most humanly sensitive response you can imagine came from Kaplan, who simply directed my attention to the fact that I had only a year and a half to go to graduate and I could survive it. And that changed my view in every way. The second course he taught was homiletics, Midrash in our time. He taught me
how to read Midrash. He taught us all how, when we prepared for his class, and we didn't dare show up in that class without having prepared, that we took the Midrash, put it into context, and not just deal with it as the excuse for a sermon. In this class, again, there was faculty-student contact. Whom are you preaching to, he would ask. What is their life like? Talk about that, or at least think about it as you formulate what you want to do in a sermon. His love of the Hebrew language came through as he asked us to read the Midrash carefully. These two teaching experiences have stayed with me all these years, and they are the memories I have of 42 to 47. I cannot close without saying that as I reflect on this, I reflect on the personal, warm friendship I had with Herschel J. Matt of Philadelphia, my contemporary. I was his contemporary. We grew together. The best way of putting it is to say that we were loyal students of Professor Kaplan, and we began when we went at age 19 from Philadelphia to New York, as we said, on pilgrimage to meet the man who was the editor of the Reconstructionist magazine, which had changed our lives. Thank you.
I'm elated that this program is taking place at Georgetown. For were it not for Mordecai Kaplan, I probably would not be here. When I came to Georgetown 45 years ago, it was very much under the influence of Kaplan, because he was one of the few faculty at Georgetown who gave me any idea of the need to study not only Jewish theology, but Christian theology as well. It was under his influence, actually, that I took a course with Reinhold Niebuhr. And one day, I commented to him about the quality of homiletics in many of the shuls that I was attending. Not very good. And he said, you know, there is a Jesuit church around the corner on 119th Street. Go there. And I remember going there, and there was no sermon. It was two Jesuits back to back, and they were dialoguing with one another. And that impressed me deeply. I'm also delighted that you're here because, as a result of Kaplan's influence upon me, I was one of the co-founders of the Program for Jewish Civilization. And that program is unlike other Jewish studies programs in that it relates to Judaism as a civilization. We have courses which deal with Jewish polity, courses which deal with Jewish religion, and courses which deal with Israel and the concept of Jewish nationalism. When I first came to seminary, I was shocked. I grew up within the conservative movement, as I thought the conservative movement was. My parents were on the National Board of the United Synagogue of America. I grew up in a congregation which had a pipe organ and superb music, a congregation which used the siddur of the Rabbi Morris Silverman, a congregation which in its day would have been considered quite egalitarian. And then I came to JTS, and I expected to find the same. Well, the first shock was that at the seminary synagogue, they did not use the siddur of the movement. They used Adler, which is an Orthodox one, and people were segregated. This was not conservative Judaism, as I had known it. And after about the first 2 weeks, I wanted to leave. And I began to speak to my father about it, and he said, no, no, stick there. And I spoke to Dr. Kaplan. Now, he was formidable in class, but what I discovered about him was that in private, he could be quite different. And there were only two seminary faculty with whom I could speak. One was H.L. Ginsberg, who taught Bible,
who was also formidable in class, but who outside of class was warm and comforting, and Kaplan. I remember the conversation I had with him. I said, I've been here 2 weeks. I want to leave. And he said, I've been here 45 years. And I've wanted to leave as well. What chutzpah on your part to think after 2 weeks that you're ready to leave. And I remember, and when I think of him, I think of modern Midrash. And I remember Midrash he shared with me. He said, you know, when Moses asked God what was his name, God said, yeah, Asher, yeah. He said, it's really future. I am becoming. And this institution under people such as you and me and other students of your like can change it, and it can become. And that had a deep, lasting impression upon me. I'd like to share three maislach with you about Kaplan, the person. And because he helped me understand concepts, particularly in relation to observance, I could never understand why he, as a Reconstructionist, who did not believe in a personal God, a supernatural God, would observe. And I remember going to him with one particular issue. I noted in class one day that he spelled God G-D. And I said, what is that about? You don't believe in that. I mean, I was taught in religious school that if you uttered the name of God outside of prayer, that a lightning bolt would come and smash you. And I said, why do you do that? Now, he had a knack. He had a knack of relating concepts to family relations. It's an old Talmudic method where the Talmudists would relate concepts, difficult concepts, to the relationship with their wives and family. And he said, let me tell you a story. He said, there's a difference between Elohim and Hashem. And the difference is this. When I go to the Metropolitan Opera, he liked me because I was an opera buff. And every Wednesday evening for $1.60, believe it or not, I would sit in the family circle of the old Met for $1.60 and watch operas. And he said to me, when I go to the Metropolitan Opera and I meet strangers, I introduce my wife to them. And I introduce them with a diminutive. This is my darling wife. He would always use the diminutive. He said, that's Elohim. That's sort of the public name of God. But when we go back to our apartment and we become comfortable and we get in bed, I don't call her Elohim. I call her Tuts. He said, the name of God is so personal that you only recite it in private. And this struck a note to me because that's what Hesha was talking about. Hesha was talking about prayer as an intimate conversation with God. And I'll never forget that. The second one relates to a similar idea, the whole idea of kashrut. I said to him, you don't believe in a personal supernatural God. So why do you observe kashrut? And I love the sociological approach that he took. He said, you know, if you don't observe kashrut and you go into a public market where they sell non-kosher meat, you don't learn anything about the Jewish community. You have no relationship to the butcher at all. It is a dehumanizing experience. He said, but when you go into a kosher butcher market, the first thing you see are announcements about what's happening in the Jewish community. You meet people and they tell you about friends of yours, who's getting married, who's getting divorced, who's having surgery. He said, it's Hamish. You learn something about the Jewish community. And not only that, you are supporting the butcher, And the butcher is supporting the shochet. And the shochet also probably may be a malamed, and he may be a moil, or he may be a scribe. In other words, you are supporting the functionaries of the Jewish community. And that brought something to mind, because the person who had a deep influence upon me when I was an undergraduate at Wesleyan was such a shochet. His name was Mr. Gross. And he actually fulfilled all of those functions. And it was he who prepared me for seminary. And one final reflection. And I can remember those walks with Dr. Kaplan. And on one of those walks, I questioned the Aleinu prayer. Why, Dr. Kaplan, did you remove the section from the Aleinu prayer which you found objectionable? And I expected him to say it was because it's not democratic. So I said to him, is it because you felt it wasn't democratic? He said, no. I said, then what is the reason? He said, well, how could a non-supernatural God choose? We choose God. God does not choose us. And I left it out. Because the choice is not God's. The choice is ours. It is our choice to embrace the world. And he shared a statement, which has always been indelible in my mark, in my mind, because he encouraged me to study philosophy, not only Jewish philosophy, but secular philosophy as well. And it was he, under his influence, it was he who introduced me to the writings of Martin Buber. And he quoted at that time a statement from Martin Buber that has always remained with me. The world may not always be comprehensible, but it is embraceable. And if there's one message that I've carried through my life to this day, it's that statement from Buber. So I'm here to express my appreciation and show you Kaplan the man, Kaplan the teacher as well. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Menachem Mendel Sholem Ben Chaim Verezel.
Who's that?
Me.
Oh, you. You okay, man?
Good morning. I was introduced to Mordecai Kaplan's writings by my dear teacher and friend, Rabbi Arthur Zuckerman, who was the Hillel director at City College in New York. One day he gave me a copy of Kaplan's The Meaning of God in Modern Jewish Religion and said, Manny, read this. I opened the book and read the first page. I was so shocked that I threw the book to the floor and said I would never read anything by this apikoros again. I want to be a rabbi. And on the first page there, he says that traditional Judaism has nothing to teach modern man. I didn't want to hear that. But I was curious. I picked the book up and finished it. By the time I had finished it, I was a Reconstructionist. The first time I actually met Mordecai Kaplan was in his home during the shiva for his first wife, Lena. He davened the Maariv service, and following it, he recited his prayer, God, the Life of Nature. One of my fellow students began laughing and said, what's he doing? He's finished Maariv already. And one of the Kaplan daughters said, don't you laugh or make noise when my father is praying a prayer that comes from his very heart. I also spent time with Mordecai Kaplan at Sedgwin camps. And one day, Kaplan and I got into a violent argument. And he said, Manny, you don't understand me. You'll never understand me. You never understood me, and you never will understand me.
I thought my relationship with him was over forever. The next morning, he comes over to me at breakfast and says, "Manny, I'm sorry. You were right. I looked myself up." When I became a rabbi in Halifax, Nova Scotia, Mordecai Kaplan came to speak to my congregation. I met him at the airport and I said, "Rabbi Kaplan, you and Mrs. Kaplan can stay either at the local hotel, in which case you would have to ride to the synagogue on Shabbat, or you can stay with some members of the congregation close to the synagogue." He replied, "Manny, what do you do?" I said, "I ride, Rabbi Kaplan." Remember that I was a little whippersnapper at that time, really. And he said, "Manny, what do you do?" And I said, "I ride." He said, "I'll do what you do. I want to be identified with you." Mordecai Kaplan and I once found ourselves in a diner, and I ordered soup and crackers. When the soup was brought to us by the waitress, he said to me, "Manny, don't eat those cookies. They're made, those crackers, they're made with lard." Once I found him sitting alone in a dark room at the SAJ, crying. I went over to him and said, "Rabbi Kaplan, why are you crying?" And he said, "Manny, the Jewish people, our Jewish people, what is happening to our Jewish people?" And then I knew what it meant to love the Jewish people with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might.
So our first question, and I'm going to, you gentlemen will decide, you know, who would like to take it on at least first. Would the new brain science alter in any way Kaplan's concept of God, in your view? We neglected to get the neuroscientists on
you
the
should
panel.
Have.
You need David Brooks. Yeah.
Is he here?
No.
We can broaden that question and sort of ask if, because it is technical, whether developments in the world and in thinking generally since Kaplan's death, in your view, as you knew him, might have altered his thinking in any particularly dramatic way.
He would have become more radical than he was.
In what way?
In every way. In every way.
Religiously, politically?
Religiously, politically, socially, economically. He was a socialist. And if there's one thing we need in this country right now, and in Israel, by the way, it's socialism.
You're such a shy person.
Kaplan or me?
I think he would have taken advantage of our modern modes of marketing. Through communication.
Kaplan tweeting.
Yes, Kaplan tweeting, because I think he often felt like he was a voice crying in the wilderness, particularly at JTS. And I think if he had had the modes of communication that we have today, he would have taken full advantage of them.
Question for Rabbi White in particular. How is Kaplan taught at Georgetown, if at all?
Oh, very definitely. We have an introductory course, which all of our majors must take. And that is an introductory course. It's called the Introduction to Judaism as a Civilization. And among the 20th century teachers, thinkers that are taught, Kaplan is foremost among them. And so Kaplan's taught on a number of levels. When I taught at Georgetown for 42 years in the theology department. And my course on 20th century Jewish thought always centered around the teachings of Kaplan.
Next question for Rabbi Spar in particular. Asked that we take you back to Smithtown in the early 60s. What was it like there in terms of Reconstructionism in the community and introducing Reconstructionism?
It was one of the greatest challenges of my life. People were ready to take me to court. People were ready to throw me out after a week. People didn't understand that I would call a woman for a bar mitzvah, bat mitzvah on Shabbat, have a woman witness a ketubah. But it didn't change over the years. When I started officiating at services for gays, I mean, there was just an upheaval all the time. And that is why I retired when I was 65. My neck got hurt. From the chopping, the constant chopping. It didn't stop until I went to the board meeting and I would say, Chuck, I saw your car at a motel. I was passing at a very funny hour. What were you doing there? Then he said, I tried to explain to him that adultery is in the Aseret HaDibrot, that you can't commit adultery. But it doesn't say anything about gays and how they make love. I thought it was our congregation, but it was never our congregation. To the last day I was there, it was their congregation, and I was the rabbi. And it came to the courts, and it came here, and it came there. And it ended by saying, you can no longer use the sanctuary as you wish. I'm the rabbi 40 years. 40 years I was there. They kept me. Why'd you keep me for 40 years? So the end of it was, they said, in your house, you can do what you want. In your office, you can do what you want. But in our synagogue, you have to come to the board. And so I learned how to negotiate that. We were our people. Once I understood that, and I understood that I was a person with many mistakes, who was daring, I worked it out. It was like that. It was never our synagogue. It was their synagogue. Today, unfortunately, rabbis are not staying in congregations 40 years, 10 years, and 12 years. We need to do something. We need to broaden the tent of our Judaism. I'm sorry for speaking so long. I just want to add one more thing. We have to open. We must be as Abraham and Sarah were, to open our doors to everybody, to everybody. That's what we have to do as Reconstructionist Jews. It's not only the sophisticated and the people at the universities, it's Amcha. You must open the doors to Amcha. If we don't open the doors to Amcha, I don't think that the Reconstructionist movement is going to survive.
Next question. The questioner says, I appreciate all that has been shared, but no one has yet mentioned spirituality. So we'll probably not be the first time we hear this sort of question today. The last time is the first. What did Kaplan teach or say about spiritual development? Rabbi Goldsmith.
Rabbi Kaplan used the word spirituality to mean religion. Nothing more and nothing less. It was for him a synonym for the word religion. What is called spirituality today, which is religion without responsibility, mysticism, romanticism, was not what Rabbi Kaplan meant when he used the term spirituality. Spirituality today has become a word for something which is not quite religion. Kaplan was pro-religion. Religion has to be improved, as everything human has to be improved. Education, medicine, transportation, politics, everything else. But the essence of it was ethical responsibility and a sense of brotherhood between people.
Well, that leads right into the next question, which I'll just read. In light of Kaplan's vision and method, how do all of you view the emergence of non- and anti-rationalists in the renewal and other movements emerging in the name of post-denominationalism, and this is the questioner's term, pseudo-mystical theologizing?
I'd like to turn back to the first question.
I think they're related, but go ahead.
Okay, yeah. They are related. Among the thinkers that I was enamored with was Eric Fromm's The Art of the Loving. And I remember talking to Kaplan about a concept. And I remember the concept very vividly, the difference between the male and female way of looking at things, the male oriented around the external and the female around the internal. And I think what he meant by spirituality was the ability of an individual not only to see the God that is without in terms of process, but also the God that is within. And for me, that's really what spirituality is about. The rebirth, the recreation of a God that is within. So even though, Ian, and Mandy's quite right, I think he would be appalled by the pseudo spirituality that exists today, but he really did have a sense of spirituality.
Religion has to be social and ethical.
Rabbi Kaufman.
Yeah, I realize that he made a very nice distinction between the irrational, the non-rational, and the rational. And we all know that the rational is what Kaplan tried to be most of the time, you know, with logic and so forth. But there's also the non-rational. I think Kaplan certainly had room for the non-rational. I don't think he would have said that you can prove the existence of God. But it's on the basis of our experience, which is a non, experience is non-rational. Experience is not necessarily rational. So I think Kaplan was open to the non-rational. But what Kaplan was against was the third thing that Eisenstein said, the irrational. Kaplan was against the irrational. In other words, the notion, credo quia absurdum est. I remember a conversation I had with him about Kierkegaard. Kaplan said, that nut, he has caused us more trouble because he's gotten people into the irrational. So Kaplan did not like the irrational.
Now, a specific question for Rabbi Kaufman. Isn't it crazy to call Kaplan's theology scientific?
Oh.
Probably not from your point of view, but go ahead.
Oh, no, Kaplan tried to be scientific. I didn't say he succeeded. he thought that Durkheim's notion of the collective consciousness of the individual was more in accordance with what I would say the scientific method of reasoning, the scientific method, than Rudolf Otto. But here's the whole point, that relates to the question which was just asked. Rudolf Otto, in the idea of the holy, straightforwardly says that his idea of God is non-rational. He doesn't say irrational, he says it's non-rational. So I think in that particular instance, Kaplan was wrong to dismiss Rudolf Otto as promulgating a feeling of wooziness, because the idea of the holy is a non-rational concept that is one of the explanations of the origin of religion. Now that's very important, because the new atheists, not just the four I dealt with in my book, but there are others. A.C. Grayling, I heard him speak. He's worse than the four I mentioned in my book. He thinks God is in the same category as fairies. To believe in God is, if you believe in God, it means you should also believe in fairies. I mean, he's absolutely devastating, and he's absolutely wrong, because Rudolf Otto points out that we have these feelings of awe, wonder, and to show you the lengths that these atheists go to, now they're trying to pick apart the concept of awe. I read one of the latest issues of Scientific American. There's this guy, Michael Shermer. Michael Shermer is, he's interesting. He was originally a fundamentalist, and then he really got disillusioned with it. Now he's one of the atheists. And he's always criticizing religion. And he tried to take apart the concept of awe in the latest issue of Scientific American. He says, He says, you can have awe of the universe. It doesn't have to be about God. You don't need God to have awe. So they go to such lengths. I'm still investigating this atheism. I'm trying to figure out what is behind it. There's such an antipathy to some of these people. They hate religion. They just hate it. There's such an antipathy there. And I really wonder how Kaplan himself would have... he said the mistake atheists make, this is the closest I can come to what Kaplan would say about it. The closest the atheists come is the notion of that they can't consider the idea that religion evolves and tries to keep pace with modernity. They just can't get that concept. So that's the only answer I would give. But they really are vehement and really are trying to destroy religious feeling by comparing God, putting God in the same category as fairies.
Great. Changing topics somewhat dramatically, this is a question I've actually heard raised in light of the resurgent debate about interfaith marriage in the wake of the Pew study. And you're free to answer that it's not a good question. You can assume it's from me as well as from the questioner. What would Kaplan say about the alarmingly or vast, quickly rising rate of interfaith marriage in the United States today?
It's terrible, but we have to do something about it. In other words, we have to learn to adapt to it as a fact.
I think he would say, embrace the non-Jewish spouse and be mikarev, and explore the possibilities of making more Jews and more Jewish families. I've thought about that question very, very frequently. And I must say that I am hampered by the law committee, which does not embrace that point of view. And I think it's a great mistake, and I wish it would change.
I would reiterate what Manny said. Kaplan, one of his basic ideas is that religion has to be affected by the social, cultural, and intellectual milieu of the day. And he would have said the same thing. I may not like it, but it's reality, and we have to deal with reality.
Another blunt and big question. Do you suppose Kaplan would be pleased with the current state of the institutional Reconstructionist movement? Just reporting, sir.
One of the things I bring out in my new book, Against the Atheist, where I conclude with Kaplan, and that is transnaturalism. But I bring out that a lot of the students of the Reconstructionist rabbinical school find Kaplan's notion of God as process or power cold, and they are searching for a personal God.
You're accidentally hitting your mic.
Oh, excuse me. So they find the idea of Kaplan's idea of God, the power that makes for salvation. My favorite definition of Kaplan's idea of God, when I bring out when Dan. I teach Kaplan in class, I just love this definition.
Dan?
God is the... What's the matter? God is the sum total of all of the animating and organizing forces in the universe that are bringing a cosmos out of chaos. I just love that definition, the sum total. So I love it for intellectual reasons, but some of the students find this inadequate, and they're searching for communion with God. So I don't know how Kaplan would react to that.
Read Bill's book.
Thank you.
Rabbi Spar.
It's as good a time as any. He would have been humbly proud of you, Dan.
Oh, no. You don't get to say that.
I didn't have to say it, but I wanted to.
No, I said you don't have permission to say it. No, thank you. I appreciate it. Rabbi White.
Okay. Chris, we knew Kaplan before the establishment of the Reconstructionist Seminary, but I remember a question I once asked him, why have you remained here so long? And in a sense, I think he thought that that what happened at the seminary was that the ideas of Schechter, for example, had been distorted, and that there may have been some hope for the seminary. And I once remember him saying something. He said, I'd rather be in a stuffy room and open the window and let some fresh air in rather than go into a vacuum. And his ideas may have changed at a later point, but at that point in his own life, I think he believed that he was the voice which had to be heard at JTS.
Next question. Given the use and sometimes angry, I take it, use of the term civilization today as in clash of civilizations, and the current state of use of the word culture in the Jewish world, do you think Kaplan would still use the term civilization or perhaps something else? Manny?
Let me tell you that Rabbi Stephen Riskin, an Orthodox rabbi, has written that he believes that the words Judaism is an evolving religious civilization should be inscribed on the walls of every synagogue in America. An Orthodox rabbi.
Mm-hmm. Other thoughts on the term civilization as opposed to culture?
I think you could ask me about Yiddish.
I think we would go, in fact, one of the things that's been recommended to us, rather than being the program for Jewish civilization, the program for Jewish civilizations, because after all, there are various civilizations within the Jewish life.
You wanted to make a comment about Yiddish, Rabbi Goldsmith.
Yes. I'm a Yiddishist, so I can't leave today without saying something about Kaplan and Yiddish. Kaplan loved everything Jewish. And when he was a student at what later became Yeshiva University, it was Yeshivat Eitz Chaim on the east side, Lower East Side of New York. He organized a boycott of fellow students who would not speak Yiddish, but who insisted on speaking English all the time. That's very significant. Judith Eisenstein also told me once that in the early years of the Yeshuv, Kaplan wanted the language of the future community to be Yiddish rather than Hebrew. He changed his mind about that later, but he had a deep love for Yiddish throughout his life, and that should be known.
Next question, coming from a teacher, I don't know at what level. What do my students today most need to know about Kaplan and Judaism in the 1950s and 1960s?
Say it again.
What do my students today most need to know about Kaplan and the Judaism of the 1950s and 1960s in North America, I assume?
You know, one of the areas that we've not talked about is Kaplan as the institution builder. And I think that's terribly important before we leave to talk about. He was the founder of the idea of the synagogue center, that the synagogue had to be more than just a house of prayer. He was deeply dedicated to the idea of Hebrew-speaking camps. In fact, he once said to me, we ought to close the cheders, all the religious schools. They're not learning anything, and concentrate really on teaching Judaism as a summer experience. He was concerned about Orthodox Jews who weren't being intellectually challenged. And wasn't he one of the developers of Young Israel?
He was one of the three founders.
Yes.
When they celebrated their jubilee,
yes.
He was the only one left alive, and they wouldn't have a celebration because they would have to honor Kaplan.
Right. Now, it's true that the institutions often ran away from him, but he was the great institution builder.
Next.
I think that the main thing that we have to teach them is what Reconstructionism is really all about. Reconstructionism is not essentially an intellectual approach to Judaism. It is essentially an extension and development of the idea of loving the Jewish people. Once you love the Jewish people, because it's our people, once you love the Jewish people, you can afford to be intellectual, reasonable, open-minded. But you must love the Jewish people. That is what every Jewish institution should be concerned with today, getting Jews to love being Jewish.
I think something else, there's a certain darkness that exists within society, a certain sense that there is no hope. But one of the things that Kaplan always impressed upon me was the relationship between the macrocosm and the microcosm, and that there is a benevolent process in the macrocosm, and we have to create that process within our own lives and within our own society. It was an element of optimism and hope that I often find not existent today.
Big picture question, if whoever cares to comment. What is your prognosis for the future of non-Orthodox Judaism, rumored to be losing out demographically?
No. The struggle for non-Orthodox Judaism is the struggle for liberal religion all over the world. The forces of liberal religion are weakening and losing. And that is because liberal religionists are not fighting for their ideas. We have to champion liberal religion. Jews, Christians, and Muslims. There are liberal streams within all religions. But they are overwhelmed by fanaticism, literalism, and stupidity. We have to fight for liberal religion. And in that fight, we as Reconstructionists are not alone. We have allies in the Christian and Muslim communities as well.
Rabbi Kaufman.
I want to indicate how difficult it is to fight for liberal religion. I have a friend, we go out to dinner, and he has his lobster or his shrimp, but he says, if I were to be religious, I would be Orthodox. It's that mentality that is a big, a formidable obstacle to the future of liberalism and religion.
You know, it's a mentality of the Shulchan Aruch, which doesn't allow choice. And I think many people are afraid of choice, but liberal religion involves the ability to make a choice.
Yeah, that's good.
And many, many people...
But are you optimistic about that future?
No.
Rabbi
Without
Spar.
Without angering anyone, there is a movement out there that has tremendous success. I live in both Long Island and in Florida. And I must tell you, I can't believe what Chabad is doing. Now, I think we need to look at what's going on. Excuse me. It's very easy to say, oh, I don't want them around me. You know why you don't want them around you? You're afraid they're going to take the money that's supposed to come to you. That's a wrong, wrong, wrong approach. They're doing something right. They're looking at the non-affiliated, and they're surviving, and they're growing. And I think that it's one of the movements around that we as Reconstructionists should look at, not in terms of what they're teaching, but how they're approaching people, how they're approaching communities. I think that it's worthwhile looking at, because I want to tell you something. They are growing by leaps and bounds.
But that success is based upon the ability to market. Okay. And that's what we have to learn.
Before we get down to yep. Rabbi Ticktin, you've been quiet at the end.
Our conversations have covered many different issues. I want to simply introduce two terms that we should talk about. One is pluralism. Kaplan was appreciative as no one before him and very few after what it means to live in an open society with possibilities that are pluralistic and tolerance for pluralism by those who have found their home. I think that helps explain part of what we're talking about. And therefore, I can't answer questions about predictions of the future. There are too many changes going on. We have survived some of those changes. Some of them we're still fighting. Two more brief comments. The family is changing, the nature of the family. The question of loyalties between the Jews and non-Jews who together found a family which would have been totally excluded in the past. The geographical movement within this country has changed the nature of family. We have to be open and non-prescriptive and describing what is an authentic Jewish family. That's it.
As a devoted Reconstructionist, I wish Chabad every success. I wish them well. I don't want us to go after one member of the Chabad movement. There are enough Jews that are not able to accept what Chabad teaches. Those are the Jews that we have to go after. There are more than enough for us.
I think the comment was first about money, but we'll come back to that later. Getting more specific now. Kaplan told an early class at the RRC that, if it were possible, he would have discarded his entire body of work with two exceptions: Judaism as a civilization and the meaning of God in modern Jewish religion. Does this make sense to you?
Yes, it's everything.
Other thoughts?
I think the meaning of God is his greatest book, yeah.
No, the future of the American Jew is his greatest book. Oh, okay. Bill?
We have about 5 more minutes. Why, if God is a mere illusion, this is the questioner again speaking, and God is only a functional brain construction, why should I as a Jew deal with that illusion and all the history of manipulation connected with that illusion instead of finding another way to deal with ethics and everything else that the God concept is meant to deal with? Sir.
I don't think Kaplan says that God is an illusion.
Now the questioner
did.
What if, anyway?
Well, okay, that's very tame. I just wrote this book about a critique of the new atheists, and I say that it used to be said by atheists that God is an illusion. That was Freud. Freud said that God is an illusion, by which he meant not that there is no God, but the idea that there may be a God is bordering on non-truth, because an illusion is something that's a product of wishes. You wish something to be so, and when you wish it, you can't be objective about it and reason objectively about it. But the new atheists go further and say, as in the title of Dawkins' book, God is a delusion. Now that's really bad, because he's saying that you have to be slightly crazy to believe in God. So that's even worse. So I think Kaplan would have tried to defend that God is a reality and not an illusion or a delusion.
Manny?
I don't believe in God. I believe in Godhood. God is not a person, but a quality of life that exists throughout nature and in the human brain and heart. And that I experience in my life. I have to think about it and try to connect myself with it and help it along. God is godliness, or not G-D, but G-O-O-D. By God, I mean the common good, what is good for me and for you and for all human beings and for our planet.
I think I'm going to push you a little bit. I think what the questioner is getting at is that we spend a lot of time straining to reconstruct that term, that for others, and particularly the fundamentalists, can be very dangerous. Why bother? Why not find other language or other ways of expressing all this? Why stick with this notion of God?
The leftists in Israel produced a Tanakh without the word God a few years ago. And it's a very interesting book, but Sohot Nishkin Yiddishin Tam.
It has no neshama.
It has no neshama, as Elliott says. What we are saying about God is what the generations meant throughout the ages. They added to it. They called nature Mother Nature and God Father God. Nature is not a mother and God is not a father, but there is a maternal quality to the universe. There is a paternal quality to the universe. And that is what we mean when we speak of God. To throw out the baby with the bathwater would be foolish.
Kaplan actually used the term religious naturalism, the whole idea that God is in nature.
Rabbi Kaplan?
What was the question again?
Why do we cling to this reconstructed use of the word God? Why not find other language?
Bill, I didn't know you had Parzheimer's like me. Not Alzheimer's, but Parzheimer's.
That's a good term.
Well, I think the speaker is recommending, if I understand the question properly, that's why I asked you to repeat it, that we stop using the term God. Is that what he's saying?
I think so. Man.
Well, there have been other people who have said that. When the death of God theology came out in the 60s, there were thinkers like Van Buren and Hamilton who said that we right. should just stop God using the God. Word God. As a matter of fact, Hamilton, one of the Death of God theologians, said he wrote a book called On Taking God Out of the Dictionary. So this is not a new thought. I mean, this is a radical theology, taking the word God out of the dictionary. I think the only defense was written by Buber, who said that the word God is a soiled term and it's been abused, but we still have no other word to express what we want to say by God. Now, I think, in my own opinion, the trouble with the word God is, and I point this out in my book on the atheists, is that it is severely ambiguous. I was a fan of Walter Kaufman, not just because I had almost the same name as him, but I studied with him in Israel. And he has a page in his Critique of Religion and Philosophy, a section called God and Ambiguity. And I'll never forget how he starts that little section. He says, there is an aspect of the word God that is often overlooked. What is it? What does God mean? That's often overlooked. And then he says, what are we talking about when we talk about God? Are we talking about the God who allegedly spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai? Are we talking about Thomas Aquinas' concept of God as the pure act of existence? Are we talking about Buber's vow, eternal vow? Or are we talking about Kaplan's power that makes for salvation? The term God is systematically ambiguous. And that's why the atheists have so much fun, because they point out all the permutations and combinations of what the word could mean. It is absolutely an ambiguous term. So that may be why this particular person who asked the question wants us to stop using it. Because if I went around the room and asked everybody what they think God is, we'd get a different answer. We'd get 200 concepts of God. So that's a big problem. The word God is systematically ambiguous.
Well, I think that's either a wonderful place to end or a frustrating
place
to end.
May I make one more remark? You know that
sure.
I can't give up so easily.
Who am I to deny?
The editors and printers of the Siddur, since Gutenberg, removed the word God. Instead of Yud Hey Vav Hey, they printed Yud Yud, right. Which means XX. They already took the word God out of the prayer book. But clever Jews said, Yud Yud means two Yuds, two Yidden, two Jews together.
Okay.
When two Jews are together, God is there.
Good.
It's a nice with that. I want to thank Rabbis Ticktin, Spar, Goldsmith, White, and Kaufman for a wonderful kickoff to our conference. My apologies to those whose questions were not answered or asked. Many of them, I think, are going to be relevant in future sessions, so hold on to them or resubmit them, please. In just a moment, we're going to break for lunch. We have boxed lunches, kosher boxed lunches in the back. We're free to spread out wherever folks like. I'm told the weather, for all the calamitous warnings about tomorrow, and I'm not minimizing them, the weather is beautiful now. You're welcome to go outside, among other places. We're not going to break for just a moment. I'm just sort of giving you the introduction because we have one important thing before lunch. And then we'll reconvene at 1. So with that, it's my pleasure to introduce Georgetown's current Jewish chaplain. You've heard from the first. My friend, Rabbi Rachel Gartner, not coincidentally a Reconstructionist rabbi.
Could there be a less enviable spot between you and lunch? It is an. I did ask for it. I think it's an honor to share this space with the G'dolei Hador. Really, it really is. So, welcome to the home of the dreamy Jesuits, in the same place where I have myself been called Father Gartner. It was a mistake. It was written on a piece of paper. But actually, it really is very, very powerful to have in this room my worlds all in one place. I'm sort of dazzled by it. And to have shared this space with the likes of Jacques Berliner Blau and Imam Yahya Hendi and Hillary Clinton and Kevin Spacey and Desmond Tutu's daughter and Rabbi White and this afternoon, Rabbi Deborah Waxman, Rabbi Jill Jacobs, Jeff Shine. I'm not trying to oversee, and all of the above et al. It's really quite an amazing thing to be here with you. Who knew? So I just want to say that Georgetown is a great place to be Jewish. This I get to plug for just a minute. Here's our slogan. With over 700 Jews, a program for Jewish students, a program for Jewish civilization, a campus rabbi, a Jewish chaplaincy, four Jewish student groups. I think that's it. Georgetown is a great place to explore Judaism. It's a wonderful host for our community, and I hope you will find it that way today. So Nivarech, let us bless, let us express our hopes and our gratitude. This is my motzi, so Bereshit, with your permission. May this conference nourish and excite our minds, inspire and quicken our souls, as this meal will sustain our bodies, and may all of this bring us towards goodness, towards salvation, towards Shlemut. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz.
Amen.
Amen.
Bunches and baskets.